This is Need for Speed Most Wanted, 2005. One of the most popular and highly rated racing games of all time, and one that I first played at such a young age I don't even have the memory of playing it for the first time. To me, and to a lot of people my age, this game is a work of art, and something that we keep coming back to once every few years, just to experience it again. Here's the thing though, if you want to buy this game today in 2025, you just can't. It just isn't available for sale from its developer, EA, on any platform. If it was up to them, this game would be forever lost to time, just gone, and no one who grew up with it would be able to play it again. This is Marvel's Spider-Man 2. Aside from the propaganda and the heroes don't kill people nonsense, it's an incredible game. Now, if you're not careful, you might think that this game is available for purchase. After all, it's right there on the PlayStation Store and on the Steam website. But really, the game itself is not actually available to buy. Not really. You can buy a physical disc for PS5, or a digital version for PS5 or PC. The thing is though, if you care about actual ownership and game preservation, if you care about actually being able to play this game 20 years from now, neither of those options will work for you. The PS5 is a proprietary locked down platform, and it's extremely unlikely you'll have a working PS5 20 or even 10 years from now. And there's no guarantee that there will be good emulators for it either. And as for the digital versions, you're not actually buying the game itself when you pay for it. What you are buying is a time-limited license that allows you to download and play the game, but the company reserves the right to take that game away from you or to modify it at any time for any reason. And someday, the company's servers are going to go offline and you will no longer have the ability to download the game that you paid for. If you already had a copy of it in a local install of Steam, you might still be able to play that. But what are the odds that you'll actually be able to do so successfully? I mean, you need to sign into a Steam account if you even want to launch the game in the first place. And what are the odds that you'll be able to do that even 10 years from now? The truth is, ownership of a digital good, like a game, is only real ownership if you have the actual game files on your file system in a format that allows you to carry them around and copy them to any PC you want and play the game without any kind of license checking or DRM or internet connection requirement or other kind of artificial lock or impediment. The only reason I can still play a 20-year-old game in 2025 is because I have the actual game files, and those files are made to run on an OS and on a CPU architecture that is so popular and so universal, I'm pretty sure I'll always have access to it, either directly or through emulation. And unfortunately, it's almost impossible these days to legally purchase a game in a way that satisfies those requirements. Companies add all sorts of bullshit, like artificial locks and DRM, to their games in the name of countering piracy, which, ironically enough, makes piracy the only way to have actual ownership of your games. I can still play Need for Speed 2005 in 2025, only and exclusively because I was able to pirate it. As they say, if buying isn't owning, piracy isn't theft. But having ownership of the game files themselves is only half the battle. I also want to make sure that I can play the game on a platform that is friendly to long-term preservation. A platform that doesn't require signing into an account, a platform that won't waste resources on logging my keystrokes or constantly keeping a detailed record of everything I'm doing and sending it to some company's servers, a platform that won't falsely label my pirated games as viruses and delete them without my consent. So that pretty much disqualifies Microsoft Windows, which is a problem because most games are designed to run on Microsoft Windows. Fortunately, most Windows games these days do work perfectly on Linux, an operating system that is actually designed to get things done rather than to extract value from its users. This is done through a piece of software called Proton, which allows Windows games to run on Linux. And in many cases, games running on Linux through Proton run better than they do on Windows, despite having been designed to run on Windows, which just goes to show how shitty Windows is as an OS. The problem with Proton is that the easiest and most user-friendly way to use it is by buying and playing your games on the Steam store, which, as we discussed earlier, is proprietary and requires a login. and therefore should not be considered a reliable or serious way to play anything that you want to be able to access and preserve for the long term. The good news is that it is possible to use Proton without Steam. So if you know how to A. pirate games, and B. play those games on Linux without depending on a proprietary service like Steam, you can maximize your chances of being able to play that game in the future and prevent it from being taken away because some big business said so. And that's what I'm going to show you how to do today. So, as a prerequisite, I'm going to assume that you already have a gaming PC with some Linux distro installed. If you don't, then you should look into Linux first and decide whether you can make the switch. I highly recommend it, and you can't really go wrong with a distro like Fedora, for example. So, if you want to own and play games on Linux, the first thing you're going to need to do is install Lutris. Lutris is basically the front end that we're going to use to organize and access our games. You can install it from your App Store, where it's most likely available no matter what distro you're using. I recommend not going with the Flatpak version, just because I've had issues with it, but you might have better luck. In my case, I'll stick to the regular distro maintained package. The next thing you'll need to do is get your hands on some games. Now remember, this video is not about torrenting or piracy in general, so if you don't know much about that, I suggest pausing now and doing a little bit of research on how torrenting works and what the piracy scene is like in general. The piracy subreddit can be a very valuable resource for this, but I'm going to give you a basic overview of the way I do things and some issues to look out for when you intend to play on Linux specifically. Obviously, this goes without saying, but I'll say it anyways. None of what I'm about to show you is real. I have never actually downloaded pirated content or really done anything illegal in my life. I've just edited the video to make it look like that. And you, of course, should never pirate games because it's illegal and unethical. Thank you. You will, of course, need a torrent client. I usually use QuickTorrent, and you'll want a place to get your actual game files from. I typically go for 1337x.to or the classic thepiratebay.org. You can search for the game you want, pick a torrent and click on the magnet link button, which will open a dialog box in your torrent client, which will let you pick where you want to save the game, and you can then start the download. Now remember, we're using Linux even though these games were meant to run on Windows, which means the installer programs for the games were also meant to run on Windows. And while game compatibility on Linux is really good, compatibility with the various installers is more of a mixed bag. When a game is cracked, the group that cracked it typically creates their own installer that they use to distribute the game. And for whatever reason, some of these installers work better on Linux than others. Personally, I've had really good experiences with FitGirl Repacks and Dodi Repacks, that's D-O-D-I. So if you want a game and you see that FitGirl or Dodi have released a cracked version of that game, I suggest going with those versions over any others. Now that you've downloaded the game, you need to figure out how to install it, and this part is where it gets a bit tricky. The first thing you want to do is open up Lutris, scroll down on the sidebar, and click the little settings icon right next to Wine. Go to Runner Options, and make sure that you've selected either GE Proton, which is the one I typically use, or any of the other options with the word Proton in it. Do not go for the Wine options, which may be selected by default. This option is out of date and will be removed in the future, so you don't want to use this. Next, you need to add your game to Lutris by clicking the plus icon on the top left. Now, if your game doesn't have an installer, if it's a portable game that can be launched directly from a file that you already have, then you would click on this option that says Locally Installed Game. But most games will be packaged in an installer, so I'm going to show you how to use that option. Click on the second option, the one that says Install a Windows Game, and then enter the name of your game and the identifier. The identifier is a unique name that Lutris uses to automatically grab an image or a picture for the game so that it looks nice in your game library, just like you can see with all the games I've already added here. You can look up a game's identifier by searching for it on the Lutris website and copying the identifier from the URL bar. If the Lutris website doesn't have your game listed, that's fine. The identifier can just be left as is, and you have the option of adding your own pictures later. Now you need to choose where the game will be installed. I just leave this as the default. Then you need to tell Lutris where to find the installer file that you've downloaded, typically named something like setup.exe. Click install and the process will start. For some reason, the installer UI is really tiny on my screen, but this is just a minor hassle because the game itself does look fine. Now on Windows, you would typically just hit next on the installer repeatedly without really paying attention, but on Linux, there are a couple of things that you need to watch out for. First of all, make sure that the installation folder is somewhere in the C drive and not the Z drive or anything else. FitGirl repacks have the Z drive by default for some reason. So if it does say something other than the C drive here, change it, make it C. The next thing you have to do is, if there is a checkbox to update DirectX, uncheck it. You don't want to update DirectX. The rest of the options can be left as is. Once the installation is complete, don't click launch just yet. We still have a couple of steps remaining. Right-click on the game entry, click on Configure, go to Game Options, and under Executable, you need to browse through the file system and find the actual executable of the game that you want to run. This is usually obvious because it will just be the name of the game.exe, and it will be located somewhere in the C drive. You may have to search for it. You should also set the working directory option to wherever the game is installed. That step may not be needed, but it's good to do anyways. And that's it. You can go ahead and launch the game. And there we go. You're now running a game that you actually own on a device that you actually own through an operating system that is designed for you and not designed to use you. And it's all running on a fully open source software stack. You've given yourself the best chance possible that you'll still be able to play the games that you've paid for 20 years from now. And you should pay for them. Piracy allows you to actually own your games, but it does not take away the option for you to still support the developers and give them the money that they rightfully deserve, so you should do that. Every one of the games that you see on my screen here that I actually own through Piracy, I have also paid for on lockdown platforms where all I got in return was a time-limited license to play. This way, it's a win-win situation. Before I end the video, there's one more thing I would like to talk about, and that is controller support. Most PC games are designed to be played with a keyboard and mouse, and they also tend to include support for Xbox controllers. But a lot of games just don't support PlayStation controllers, and even the ones that do might not have controller support when run on Linux through Proton, even though Linux itself does have perfect support for PlayStation controllers. So, for example, if you're playing a Sony exclusive game like Spider-Man 2 using a PS5 DualSense controller, then the haptic triggers do work perfectly out of the box, and so does the touchpad, but you don't get regular vibration or rumble support. If you're playing Need for Speed Most Wanted, a game from 2005, then at least from my copy, the DualSense controller does somehow work through Proton, but again, without rumble or vibration support. If you're playing Cyberpunk 2077, the controller doesn't work at all via Bluetooth, but it does work through a wired connection. Weirdly enough, a more recent Need for Speed Rivals, doesn't work at all with the DualSense, regardless of how it's connected. So as you can see, DualSense or DualShock controller support through Proton on Linux is hit or miss. It's not guaranteed to work, and when it does, you might still miss some features. The good news is that there is a way to make PlayStation controllers work even with games that don't support them. The bad news is that you'll have to depend on Steam. There is no open source, fully offline way to do it as far as I've seen. So here's how you do that. You need to open Steam, go to your library, click on Add a non-Steam game, search for Lutris, select it, and click Add. The next thing you want to do is open up the game properties for Lutris, go down to the controller section, and make sure that Steam Input is enabled. Steam Input is basically a translation layer that will take inputs from your PlayStation controller and convert those into Xbox controller inputs, which will be accepted by pretty much all PC games. Now, if you want to launch a game with Steam Input enabled, then instead of opening Lutris up directly as an app on your system, you'll instead open Steam and then launch Lutris through Steam using this big green button. Now, if you launch any of these games, They will detect your PlayStation controller as an Xbox controller and will support it where previously they did not. Again, this should only be done on an as-needed basis because in some cases it might actually make your experience worse. But when you intend to play a game that you know doesn't work with your controller, this is what you need to do. And hey, if you were not raised to be a console peasant like me, then you'll probably want to use the mouse and keyboard anyways. So that's it for now. I do plan on making a similar video focused on VR games, that is a whole other can of worms on Linux. So subscribe if you want to stick around for that. Thanks for watching and have fun actually owning your games.